This is a video I teased earlier in the year and it's been a long time coming. So I break down the top books that every structural engineer should have. But stick around to the end because there's a book that you likely haven't heard of and should be part of everyone's tool chest. Every engineer should have a general engineering handbook, which gives you general guidance across a broad range of topics. It's a really good way to start if you're starting out scheming. And it's really best for in your early careers, even a little bit later, if you just need a little bit of a refresher on your knowledge. Depending on when you are, there may be a different variety of these. See, back in the day, there's actually a book back here. It's very close to what you typically get there. We see in a book like this, it gives you a large variety of different designs, how to look for soils, some of the red lights. So if you're looking at foundation design, what are some of the bad things that you're looking for? It even comes up with flexible design charts for, say, flexible pavement, highway curves. This one's very general and more for a civil engineering practice. Look at some of the guidance here. Especially if we have a look here, we've got stuff based in the US. And even some examples of types of trusses that you may want to use. So it gives you good guidance on where to start and gives you knowledge that's been tested over time. Also gives you some things of known errors and stuff that you may have seen. So potentially back in the day, you've seen some mistakes that engineers have made and they've listed it in here so you don't make it on your own designs. So general engineering design book is something that every engineer should pick up. But if you just need a little bit more knowledge, it's always good to get some more bespoke books about some of the topics that you may cover. Recently, I've been doing a lot of steelwork, and there's another book here that we can see back here that gives us that good guidance. And this is for Australian standards, but pick up your own one. A good steel designer's handbook gives you all the details about different types of connections, how the type of designs that you need to go through, looking at the standard bolts, what the grades, what the strengths are, standard detailing, and even if you need to get into more complex designs, such as bearing joints or prying actions, for example, they've got you covered in this type of book. So it starts off with the basics, especially on that steel design, but goes into the more complex design in more detail, more than what a general engineering book would cover. So if you're working with steel and steel structures, make sure you pick up some sort of steel designer's handbook. If you're in Australia, this is the one that I recommend. Another really common topic that a lot of engineers deal with is concrete structures. Now, concrete can be quite broad in range and needs a lot of detailed advice because it behaves differently than steel. It has this non-linear behavior. More bespoke books on concrete design is really needed. As you can see, I've got this hardy book by Warner, Reagan, and Hall, which is Concrete Structures. If you can pick up one of the older books, it's really helpful, but you will need the amendments for the new codes. However, a lot of the time, the actual structural design doesn't change that much, just how you get to those answers. So having a good solid book that gives you a really detailed analysis about how to design for concrete structures is really important. This book covers both RC and PT. I know potentially they have split it into two separate books now, so when you are looking to pick it up, making sure you're picking up the one you need or potentially picking up both of them. It covers in detail about the behaviors of load paths, how concrete structures behave, increased deflections, curvatures, and general behavior of concrete structures. And as you can see, it's a really chunky one, and it goes into a lot of detail depending on what topic that you need to cover. So if you do need to start out with a more complex concrete design, this here has got you covered for Australian standards. Again, it's very similar. Most of the topics can be quite general, so it can be beneficial, even if you're designing for an overseas code standard. But if you are looking for something a little bit more general, you can't go past a book by Stephen Foster. Stephen Foster is one of the leading researchers in RC concrete structures. He's produced a book, The Reinforced Concrete Basics. He'll go into detail about how to design for concrete structures, focusing on both practical and current designs, plus any updates that you have to the code. So if you do need to refresh your knowledge and have that detailed analysis in concrete structures, Stephen Foster's book is also something you should have close at hand. The other real benefit of this is it gives you a step-by-step guide and illustrative examples of how to design for those RC structures. So if you're looking for a more of a work-through example, though they do have it in here, you're going to find additional advantages from Stephen Foster's book. Precast Design's Handbook is another book that you potentially may need to pick up if you're doing a lot of precast design. As opposed to concrete structures, which is typically in situ, precast adds a lot of additional complexities about how you have to behave the joints, how you join stuff together, and some additional analysis that you may need to go into. I would recommend that you pick up the time-determined behavior of concrete structures. This is really where you're getting into more complex RC shells, how structures actually deflect and move, additional stresses that you may have in there. This is really giving you that detailed analysis. So if you're doing complex structural design, especially around precast behavior and need to know the ins and outs of RC design, that's the time-dependent behavior of concrete structures. Talking about moving into the complexity, a lot of time understanding how structures behave is really important, but also knowing how stress and strain behavior affects you. As all structural behavior is around stress and strain behavior and how stresses flow through elements. This is where I'd recommend you pick up Rourke's formulas for stress and strain. This provides you the detailed analysis if you're doing more of that really complex design. It does have a lot of behavior on vibrations, how structures actually resonate. So looking at that really complex analysis, if you're doing that more detailed design, you don't need it often, but when you do, it's something that you have to have close at hand to give that detailed analysis to make sure that you are designing things correctly. It has exhaustive tables and equations for various loading scenarios. It has analysis of plates, beams, shells, columns under different conditions. Chapters on vibration, dynamics, and essential behavior of structures. So if you're working on complex designs with dynamics behaviors, Rourke's Stress and Strain Guide is something you need at hand. Coming for something you potentially haven't seen, unless you've been watching my videos, you've seen it come up before. This is a book that everyone should have close at hand in every single library when they're going through their engineering. You see, us as engineers, we do computational analysis all the time, but do we actually know how it works? Do we know some of the complexities, how to break it down and how to analyze it, where the faults are happening before? This book breaks down all about computational engineering, starting off with the basics and going all the way through ML and AI. So how can you actually leverage it for your benefit? And what are the drawbacks that you currently can see? I was actually lucky enough to meet Pete Debney when I was in London for the iStruct.de meeting. He actually introduced me to this book, and this is how I got a hand of it, and he actually gave me a signature. This is sold in the iStruct.de library. I would recommend that you all pick up at least one copy for your team so they can have a look in detail about what this book is about. This was actually a collaboration between a fair few people, but Peter Debney was the main writer between here. So some of the key things when I was reading through this book, how structures are actually analyzed and how grillages and plates actually work. So what are the actual drawbacks that you may have in an element? When do you need to build a model? What suitable problems are you trying to solve? So are you using the right materials? Is a model more efficient or could you do it a different way? So these are some good questions that can force you to answer. And for example, if you're doing nonlinear behavior, what's the different stress strain curves that you may need to apply? And also, how can you resolve some problems? So this is probably something you should all look at, is saying what are the problems that you've seen in existing structures and how they've actually affected them. There's many good examples back in the day of where structures and models have actually said it's fine. So if you had a look at the model results, nothing should have happened wrong. But some of the connection detailing and not understanding what questions you should be asking or how you should be designing things was overlooked. This book goes into detail. Even some of the things that you may forget is that you think about torsion, it's often overlooked and forgotten. You normally just pin it and get rid of it. But if you do, potentially you're overlooking some high stresses that may cause big problems. Another good example is when you're looking at stresses through models and you've got a flat plate and you're just pushing in one direction and looking at the stresses. Those stresses can be significantly less than the stress that you should be designing for. Because what happens with the model, especially if it's linear, it doesn't crack. It doesn't crack, it's still holding onto stress when it shouldn't. So you can have an increase that's dramatically higher by looking at a nonlinear model. This is why sometimes a less complex model that doesn't have some of those flaws in such a plate system can see it correctly, because just a simple model with some stick frames and simplified the pin joints to making sure that you're not getting those secondary stiffness actions can actually more realistically show the tension forces that you're going to achieve and see, as opposed to those plate models that you may think is more beneficial. It also goes into the benefits of mesh. Have you ever thought about, could you be doing it too fine or too coarse? Another great example, especially when you're looking at optimization, is how topologies can make a big difference. See, topologies and the way the building actually behaves can have a big increase on the type of stresses that you see or the materials that you're thinking about. When you think about trusses, you just think about the standard ones, isn't the best, but there can potentially be significant optimizations in how the structure is actually formed for where the forces actually go. And a great example of this is by the ETO steelwork designers, where they go from the original one on the left, going across to the one on the right, where you can see a significant reduction in material. This is just through optimization, and you can see it's becoming more and more organic as the forces flow through the element where they need to go. So you can have significant impacts through just some decent optimization in a simple structure. You can actually break down complex problems about how you're trying to get to the right answers from analysis results that you have, and how this actually can affect your designs. So this is a book I've gone on to a little bit in detail. Now, we just talked about the type of books that we had. There's no point actually having all this knowledge if you don't store it somewhere. So it's really good to try and summarize this, create spreadsheets utilizing it, actually create summaries and guidance, making sure that you're storing that knowledge somewhere so that you can call on it later. And if you love to pick up books, you will love to learn about FEA. And if you're interested in supporting the channel, there's two ways that you can do this. You can either become a YouTube or Patreon member. Without the support of my YouTube and Patreon members, this type of content would not be possible. Keep learning, and I hope to see you next week.